Very good afternoon to all of you. Ensuring that we don't have any emotional distance between us, we continue with our Saturday talks. And today, as we know, we are going to be talking about ways of building emotional distance. Actually, there are two different angles to it. One is what happens if automatically an emotional distance develops between you and somebody else. So you have a relationship, you are connected to somebody, you are interacting with somebody, but suddenly you find that emotionally you are getting, you know, distance from that person. There's no emotional connect with that person. So why it happens, what you need to do, and how you can do that is a topic by itself. I'm not going to be discussing that today. Maybe some other time we'll fix it up as a topic and we will take that up. Today, what I am talking about is where you want to build an emotional distance with somebody. We always talk about the fact that there are certain people in our life from whom you cannot physically go away. They may be your family members, they may be your colleagues in office, they may be people, you know, who are part of your social gathering or whatever. And you realize that even if you're not very happy with that individual person or a group of people, you can't really walk off from that place just because of those people and whatever, you know, is happening to you in your interactions with them. You can't give up the whole, you know, group. You can't give up the family, you can't give up the office group, you can't give up the social groups. So physically, there is no way to get away from such people with whom you do not seem to be connecting well. Now, what do you do under these circumstances? I am not happy with this person, but I can't seem to get away from this person. So what are the ways and means by which we can at least reduce our hurts or reduce that tension or stress or whatever you want to call it by building what we call as an emotional distance? So I allow an emotional gap to come between me and that person. And therefore, even if that person has certain habits, certain actions, certain words, I cannot say that I will eliminate the outcome of that or the effect it has on me, but at least I can reduce it. And what are the ways and means and how do we go about it? We start with something as simple as, you know, we need to protect. But most common, you know, when does this happen? When there is a constant criticism. The other person is somehow, you know, saying things about you, putting you down, making remarks about you. And as I said, you can't physically get away from that person. That is when these situations, you know, happen where you feel, can I not in some way build up an emotional distance so that I don't have to, you know, have a continuous interaction with this person, or at least can I sort of reduce the effect that it is happening on me? The answer to that lies in what I would say, that you should learn how to respond and not react. Whenever something unpleasant happens, when I'm interacting with somebody and that somebody says something or does something, or I come to know that the person has done something, the instant thing is to react to that. Now, that is a skill that we need to learn, all of us, regardless of whether we have somebody whom we want to build emotional distance from or not. We need to ensure that we develop that habit that whenever something negative or whenever something unpleasant we are faced with, we shall learn not to react but to respond. And the simplest of that, I have mentioned this number of times before, is to take time. The proverb which says, you know, count to 10. You don't literally count to 10, but you give that 10 or 20 seconds before you say something or before you react. you get empowered to respond in a better way. This I'm first talking about that day-to-day situations with somebody from whom you want to build emotional distance. Then we'll go deeper into how we can, on a long-term basis or on a permanent basis, how we can do. First is to try and ensure that today, if somebody is saying something and I can't physically get away from that person, if I can take time. Sometimes, you know, you just say, excuse me, and pick up a glass of water and drink it and then turn back to talk to the person. Sometimes it could be that, you know, I just need to use the washroom and you go away. You spend that 1 minute, splash water on your face, come back and then respond to the person. So if you learn how to not react, but to think for some time, whether it's that 10 seconds or 2 minutes or whatever it is, and then we will respond. Similarly, if it is something very serious, if that person is saying something or doing something which is affecting me very badly, there's another proverb which says, sleep over it. Do not respond at the same time or same day. Take time and fix up to respond on the next day. Sleeping over an issue really gives you a good perspective on how to not get away or how to minimize the impact. The other important thing is not to feel guilty. Time and again, I have been coming across counselees, or I have been reading up on case studies and research papers where, you know what, we talk about that gaslighting type of thing, which is very popular now, that somebody makes you feel that you have done something wrong. And that is why the person is criticizing or condemning you. Now, you cannot stop that person from saying whatever unpleasant or nasty things the person is saying. But you should definitely stop yourself from feeling responsible, from feeling taking the blame on yourself, and from feeling guilty about it. The more you rationalize your thoughts, your guilt reduces. Otherwise, the bombardment of the other person who is putting you down, who's condemning you, criticizing you, somewhere, you know, it seeps into your mind and you start questioning yourself. This person must be right. How come this person is going on saying this thing? I must be doing something wrong, no? I must be responsible. I must be holding on to the blame. I am guilty. Now that, if you can make it a habit, in fact, make a note somewhere, if you're facing an unpleasant relationship from where you want to distance yourself, please write the word guilt somewhere, maybe on your notepad or you know, in front of your wardrobe or mirror or somewhere, and constantly look into seeing whether I am being infused with a guilt, with a feeling that I am responsible. I am must be doing something wrong. Otherwise, why would this person keep constantly saying the same thing negative about me? Achha, why does this happen? Somewhere, I would put it as, in a simple word, as incompatibility. I and X have become or are incompatible. So we do not think in the same way, our attitude is different, or our value system is different, or whatever it may be. When that happens, we need to, on a long-term basis, start thinking whether I can make efforts, if not immediately, on a long-term basis, to cut off this relationship or to create a physical distance with this person. Many a time we feel that, no, I cannot do that. After all, this person is so and so. And believe me, whether we admit it or not, there's a lingering thought in our mind that I can bring about a change in the other person. If I'm nice to the other person, if I'm tolerant, if I just keep, you know, taking in whatever negativity this person is giving to me, sometime or the other, the person will realize and the person will change. No. Unfortunately, it's the other way around. the person starts taking you for granted and increases the negativity against you. So we use a technique which is used in places like the stock exchange and all that, where they say, cut your losses. You have invested in a share, stock, whatever it is. The stock is going down. You have bought it at 100 rupees. It has become 98, 96, 94, 92. You're so desperate that if I sell it now, I'm going to lose 8 rupees. If I hang on, the curve may change and the price may again go up. And once it goes above 100, then I'll sell it off. But you know what a wise person does? A wise person cuts his losses. He calculates, can I afford to let go of 8 rupees? Yes, I can. It's not going to make me bankrupt. So sell at 92. And then you will realize that it goes on to 90 or 88 or 86. Some people even buy it at 86 because I sold at 92 and now I'm buying it at 86. So I've recovered some 6 rupees of the loss that I have made. Others say, no, this doesn't look good enough for me. I made a mistake. I admit, I acknowledge that I made a mistake. Can we do the same thing with relationships? My only mistake, which I think I should acknowledge, is that I got into a relationship, or I allowed this person to make this relationship toxic. Somewhere I have contributed to it by being nice, by being docile, by not, you know, giving it back to the person, etc. But if even today I can cut losses in whatever possible way, think about it deeply. You'll be amazed. You will find some answer, some loophole by which you can take. The other thing is, take a relationship vacation. Normally, vacation means what? Getting away from the house or from that environment or from that office and going away somewhere. If possible, think about taking a relationship vacation where I don't necessarily have to physically move away from that premises, but I stop interaction under some pretext or giving some excuse and saying, for some time, you know, let's give time to each other to rethink. I know of many people who have done that. They have very nicely, pleasantly, but assertively told the other person, I think there is some negativity in our relationship. I think something is not going very well. So can we just, you know, reduce our interaction with each other? Whatever is minimum necessary, we'll do. But otherwise, can we just take an emotional vacation? Think for ourselves. Do our own thing. Be there for each other if there is a need for that. But otherwise, we are not going to unnecessarily interact. That is one thing which I have seen people practicing, and practicing successfully. And that can also be extended to set boundaries on topic, on space, on time. I have a student who says that she and her husband have both got very strong political views, and they are on the opposite side of the spectrum. One spouse feels very strongly for one particular type of political leaning or political party. The other spouse is exactly the reverse. Equally strong belief and equally strong connection with the opposite or the very variant form of political leaning and political party. At one point, they took a decision. She told her husband, in the house, between you and me, we will not talk politics. We will not even make a casual remark. Oh, today that party did this, or that one got elected, or that one did this, or something. No comment on anything political between you and me. It took some time. Initially, both of them would slip and suddenly make a political comment. The other would remind, saying that, no, this is something that we are not. We both will go and talk to anybody else. We have friends who are like-minded or opposite-minded. With them, it doesn't matter. No, when you're not close to that person, even if you have very opposing views, you can always discuss it without feeling bad. But when it is somebody very close to you, in this particular case, your own spouse, it may be better to say that we will set boundaries on this. And politics is only one example I'm giving you. Sometimes it could be something to do with children. They have very opposing views about their child. They're both, you know, they produced a child, but they have opposing views. So can we stop discussing our child, particularly after a child has grown up or whatever it is. So it's not even that on a day-to-day basis, we have to take care of the child. So we have differing viewpoints on our own child or our parent or our in-law or whatever it is, but we are not going to discuss. Another very good way is to set time. This type of discussion, no, we have to discuss our child. How can we not discuss? We have to discuss about our parent. Can we allot a time slot? We will talk on this topic only between 7 and 8 p.m. All other times, even if I have strong views, I'll keep it to myself. You keep it to yourself. Try it out and see if it is possible. As I said, it will not eliminate the emotional disturbance, but it will significantly put it down. Okay. Now here, there's another thing that I wanted to tell you. I know of people who have physically distanced from somebody with whom they were not getting along, but they can't let go emotionally. I know of couples where a person has separated or even divorced, but the ex-spouse is still in the thoughts and emotions. People who keep electronically stalking their ex-spouse or ex-boyfriend, girlfriend also, even that I have seen in many cases. What is that person doing? What is the social media, outcome of that person? Who is that person befriending and all that? That's a very, very dangerous thing. When you know that physically the relationship is over, you have to work towards removing the emotional aspect. If you can't do it by yourself, take the help of some elder or some counselor or some wise person. But if you find yourself emotionally in some way, even in a negative way, of course, connected to the person from whom you have physically distanced yourself, it can be very, very harmful and you have to let go. And to be able to do that, you have to learn the second pillar of emotional intelligence, which is management of emotions. Can I manage my emotions very well? There's a simple little exercise also, which at least to some people I've seen, it does help. What is that? You look at the person objectively as though you are a third person. Instead of me, if X or Y or Z was there, how would they interact with this person? Or how would they feel about this situation? Extend that to say, in the future, what is going to happen? If I isolate myself, if I insulate myself from the effects of these, what is going to be the long-term impact? Observe the future, 2 years, 20 years from now. What will be the outcome of whatever I am planning to do? When you do that, you also get a very broad perspective. You look at the holistic picture instead of getting bogged down with the issues which are happening at present. There's a very nice quote which I read recently. I will repeat it for you. It says, by creating space, we are also able to reframe the situation in more abstract terms. For example, during an argument, I might feel that my partner or the opposite person is angry with me because of the task on hand, because that person is being very critical. Whereas when you create space, no, you can look and realize that the partner feels that you're not listening to them when they are complaining about something. That's all it may be. So by creating this space and, you know, that little bit of insulation, you can look at the main issue, the problem, the thing which is actually creating the unpleasantness from a much broader, you know, perspective. These are some of the basic things, but to actually create that distance between you and the other person with whom you're not getting along or from whom you're getting a lot of negativity, I just made out a few bullet points and Anis has made it into a small slide type of thing so that you get it in that, you know, bullet form and you can have it and keep it with you. What are the ways of building emotional distance between you and the other person? To create that distance, the first is respond quietly and with a serious tone. Not in an angry tone, not in a submersive or, no, no, I don't think so, please, no. Just respond quietly with a serious tone. I have different views on this. I'm not sure whether I agree with you on that. I need to think a little more on that. This seriousness and this subdued nature always helps in impacting the other person. You become submissive, the person starts crawling all over you. You become aggressive, it becomes a ding-dong battle. So do not do either of them. Respond quietly with a serious tone. The second point which you can use is make eye contact for a short time and have a neutral or no expression on your face. This is something very interesting. When you have a very serious, calm, you know, demeanor, and you're not looking away at that person and you're not glaring at that person, but you are making eye contact. The message getting to the other person is that, yes, I'm with you. I am paying attention to you. I am concerned about this discussion that we are having, but I am not going to support you. And at the same time, I don't even want to get into an argument with you. That is the message that comes across to the other person. And in many cases, the person gets a little, you know, shaken up or a little flabbergasted. The third one is that when you are responding to these negative comments or criticism or whatever it is, give very short replies. And where there is a need to give some details, only when you have to give the details, give that details. This did not happen last month because last month I was busy with this. I am not going against you, but I do not appreciate this that is happening between us. And where even you don't have to give details, give very short replies. As I keep telling in our counseling classes in DCS, sometimes an amazing comment, which is common to all languages, if the person says, let me think. This has an impact. You don't even realize how much of an impact these small, small things have. You have to practice it to see actually how these things are, you know, work. The other is, you know, a lot of people who are negative towards you, who are actually trying to put you down or criticize you or whatever they are doing, what they do, you know, they try to make it as though it's a lighthearted thing. They try to crack jokes. They try to, you know, create that impression. Hey, why are you taking these things seriously? What's wrong with you? Why are you so negative about it? Why are you taking it as a personal comment? Ha, ha, ha. See how upset this person is getting just because of this. Okay, that is a technique or a very negative attitude of that person to try to put you down. But you know what you have to do is you maintain your dignity and your poise. You should never laugh at jokes of people with whom you are not getting along. Even if the joke is funny and you feel like laughing, control yourself. That way you are conveying that, and nobody can say, why are you not laughing? Nobody can question you on that, because that shows that that person is not in a frivolous mood as he's trying to pretend. He's getting serious. He's, you know, attacking you. But what are you doing? You're just keeping quiet. You're not showing any warmth. You're not nodding your head, or you're not smiling or laughing. You're just maintaining calm and peace and silence, as though you don't matter to me. Your jokes don't make me laugh. Your overtures don't make any difference to me. When the person does that, the other person gets a little, you know, shaken up. And it becomes very difficult for that person to go on with trying to put you down, or trying to, you know, crack jokes at your expense, or whatever it is. So these are known as techniques and stuff like that, which a lot of people who don't like you, or who want to, you know, dominate over you, or who are very self-centered, they do it. And since you can't change them and you can't run away from them, these techniques help you to insulate yourself and to maintain your dignity, and at the same time maintain your peace of mind. The fifth one, as far as possible, when you come across that person or when you're entering into that particular environment, avoid saying hello. And when you are leaving, avoid saying bye-bye. Just nod at that person or make eye contact and look away. You're sending out a clear signal that you are making me unhappy. So while I'm not going against you, I'm not ignoring you, or I'm not, you know, trying to show off that I don't like you or something. I'm treating you like anybody. If there is a, you know, watchman or doorman who is opening the door for me, how I would just give him a glance and nod my head and I would move off. I'm going to treat you in that manner. I am not going to allow you to have even a simple, you know, thing like me having to say, hello, how are you? Good morning, namaskara. And then when you're leaving, saying bye-bye, bartini, this, that. You just ignore that. Very simple tips. You may say, will it really work? Will it have any effect? I assure you that it will have effect, provided you do it consistently. The sixth one is, if they ask you to come out, if they ask you to do some activity together or something, just say, I am busy. Minimum excuse, minimum words, no, I won't be able to join you. No, I can't do this today. Whatever it is, have that assertiveness to say no to the person. If that person, you know, uses it as a means to shout and blow his top or something, it is, he is a loser. You don't have to lose anything about that. And then we come to the last one. When you do this number six, no? Keeping away from the person, minimizing the contact, not obliging them. Do not suggest alternatives. Don't make the mistake of saying, not today, some other day I will do it. The person will catch you on that. Okay, tomorrow is Sunday, will you do it for me? Tomorrow you're not busy. So never suggest any alternatives. Look the person in the eye and say, no, I cannot do it. I am busy. I will let you know later. I don't think this is possible for me. As long as you take these very simple tips and techniques, you can really minimize the impact of people from whom you cannot get away physically, but you want to get away emotionally. Now, I don't want to get away emotionally from you people, but I need my 1 minute break. So Anis is here. She'll just quickly give you one or two important announcements, and I will be back before you know it.
Hello, good afternoon to all of you. Happy to back here. Yeah, just wanted to tell you all that, you know, we are going to have our Manthan camp. This camp is, you know, at a retreat which is there near Bangalore. It's a very, you know, interactive, lots of activities happening in this camp. And, you know, what we, I believe personally also, that we are responsible for our happiness. So this topic is same on that, being happy with yourself. Unless and until we don't understand ourselves, we don't be happy with ourselves, I don't think so we can do justice with our other family members. A Manthan is a place where, you know, it's full of greenery, you are there in midst of nature. Leave everybody behind, come one day here. Because every time, every Saturdays, we meet you, you know, but meeting in person is a totally different thing. Yeah, so one more thing I would like to tell you is, you know, recently Ali sir and Purnima and our team had been invited for different various career talks they had been. And we have been regularly invited for the outdoor programs. Dr. Ali had been for Kolar, then recently to Chintamani, then Hubli. So continuous, these type of programs are going on. And today also, last morning and this morning, again, he had been to a reputed school where they had invited him to speak on the career part for the students of 10th, 9th to 10th and 12th standard. What next they need to choose, how they need to choose, what are the subjects available. So even the parents were involved. So today, the first half, he was there with those parents and students. So it was a good thing that he was there. And people are getting benefited, because in the long run, next another 30, 35 years, the students will be working and they should be happy with what they are doing there. So I'm, you know, so our whole team of Banjara had been there for the workshop. And for that, you know, we do conduct regularly these aptitude tests, wherein this test is going to help the student to know their potentials, their strong skills, their aptitude, where it lies. And we have, my knowledge is, we have three generations also who are doing, who have taken up this aptitude test and which have helped them a lot in choosing their careers. So hope to see you again at Manthan. It would be very happy that, you know, instead of the virtual what we meet, if you people can come, or you can spread this word to your friends, or somebody is looking out for a break, they want to come learn here, learn how to be happy with their self. It would be very nice. I will be sharing the numbers. The dates you can note down. It will start from 17th November, 5:30 p.m. And it will be ending by 19th November, Sunday by 2 p.m. So next we will be having our question hour session, and sir will be back here. Meet you soon again next week. Thank you.
Yes, I'm back. Since these are little warm afternoons, instead of a tea break, I take a Pepsi break. But I'm recharged and back with you all to have a nice open discussion. Let us start with Veena, who says, but after the divorce, if couples still have to be responsible for their minor child, the emotional connection has to exist, I feel. See, there's a difference between emotional connect with regard to your child, that this is our child, so there is an emotional impact on what we do with the child, what is good, what is bad, how it is. But what I am talking about is the emotional impact between the two of you. If you start focusing, he said this or she said that, why did he do this and why did she do that? That is where emotionally you go into a turmoil. So if you restrict yourself and say this is only to do with the child. See, you have a child who goes to school. Now there is a teacher there who is responsible for the child. The teacher spends hours and hours as the class teacher of the child. So there are a lot of things that you need to discuss. And you may not necessarily agree on everything. But what do? Emotionally, you distance yourself from the teacher. This teacher is not very reasonable in so many areas. I have differences with regard to the opinion of how to deal with children. But I can't help it. I am the parent and she is the teacher. So we have to do it. Look at it purely from that point of view. It's not very difficult if you make up your mind and say that I will, keep this relationship only to the effect of children. Yes, I also agree with Veena that once in a while it may happen that you get emotionally charged about something. Something which you feel is good for the child and the other partner says, no, I feel it has to be. Obviously, emotions will run high. Doesn't matter. Because you're making it clear that it is in the welfare and the well-being of the child. That's why I'm getting emotional. Otherwise, I've got nothing to do with you. The more you show your, autonomy and your self-acceptance and not getting into emotional interactions with the ex-spouse, the better you will be able to handle it. Vinita says, I totally agree what you just said, but how do we handle few people who are very pushy and just don't give up, especially with those who we can't avoid them to, though we have given enough signals to them? Yes, you have given enough signals. The person is pushy. The person refuses to take your signals or to oblige you or whatever it is. But what is important is, since you can't, get away physically from that person, allow that person to be pushy. But the impact that it has on you is what you need to work on. If you look at this person very objectively, supposing it was happening outside, that was why one of the things that I said, that observe yourself from a distance like a third person. Visualize, this is not happening to me. It is happening to a good friend of mine. And he or she is going through the same situation, what I am actually experiencing. If I can look at it objectively and say, what are the options available to this person to protect herself? What are the ways and means by which she can minimize? What will have a good long-term impact, even if she has to suffer today? What is the methodology or the foundation she can build so that in the long term she doesn't get affected by it? When we try to look at things objectively, as though it is happening to a third person, I know it's not that easy because your emotions are directly involved, right? But it is not impossible also. These are some very simple techniques which require a lot of practice. If you can practice it, you will be able to succeed. And all these things, week after week, whatever tips, techniques I give you on human relationships and your emotions and all that, remember that only initially it is difficult. But if you agree, if you believe in it, and if you know that this is needed by me, then you can start practicing, put your time and energy, you will flounder, you will make mistakes, you'll feel even more miserable. It is like learning how to ride a bike and you fall down and you hurt yourself and you feel even more miserable. But eventually, once you learn this technique, it will become a lifelong asset. Every one of these topics that we take up from time to time, what I'm trying to do is the motto of Banjara Academy, enriching lives through empowerment. Now, I can go through the process of empowering you, or rather not even empowering you, but giving you ways and means by which you can empower yourself. And that leads to enrichment of your life. Your quality of life improves. In the long run, your relationships improve. With some people, it will get bad also. But it's worth cutting off relationship with that person and then sticking to what is good for you. Okay. Now, Roshan says, I am trying to keep an emotional distance from a very close friend who is always putting me down, criticizing me, talking behind my back. I sincerely pray and I get help some way or the other to be away from her. This is what I was telling you. It takes time, effort. So this person, you know, who happens to be a close friend or whatever, for some reason, you know, you can't just cut off with that person. But if, like Roshan, you make those efforts, understand objectively that this is her temperament, that she puts you down, she criticizes you, she talks behind your back, accept it that this is how she is. She's not a small child that I can change her. So once I have accepted that, I know that I can't expect anything better from her. Only I need to insulate myself. Shobha says, before DCS happened in my life, I was so weak and vulnerable to such type of people. Now I am stable and I decide the person who is worth for me. Others I totally ignore. I have a lot of peace of mind today. Thank you so much, Banjara. You made me so. Yes, we can all use. This is a sort of testimonial which Shobha is saying, whether it is Banjara or wherever you learn from, that's not important. We are not some gurus or people giving gyan or whatever it is. We are just facilitating the process of introspection and thinking. And a lot of people like Shobha have used whatever little things that we have been teaching through DCS or through interactions with Banjara or whatever it is. It's a mutual exercise. We all learn from it. We all take advantage from it. And when that, you know, happens, what we need to do is to understand that I will not be weak and vulnerable at an emotional level. The same way as if somebody is attacking you and you keep a stick in your hand to ensure that they won't do anything. I was very surprised long back when I was doing a project in a very remote area, which is full of all these, you know, some gangs fights and dacoits and some shootings and all that. I had hired a Jeep taxi, and I noticed under the seat, this fellow had crude bombs and he had a huge machete, you know, almost like a sword type of thing. And he seemed to be a very sweet and nice person. I said, why do you carry all this? You are getting involved in those gang fights. He said, no, sir. I have never got involved in those gang fights and I don't have any intention to do it. But people know that in my Jeep, I carry these bombs and this machete and they don't touch me. So what has he done? That vulnerability, that anytime they can attack him or something without his fault, he has protected himself, right? The same way you can protect yourself at the emotional level. You can make sure that you give out a picture, a sort of image to others. Don't play around with me. I don't get affected by you. I don't care what your thinking is. It makes no difference to me. But what I do know is, I am not getting involved in this whole process. I have nothing against you. I'm not going to fight with you. I'm not going to get into arguments with you. But at the same time, yes, whatever interaction we have to do because we are close to each other or we are related to each other, I will do it. But at an emotional level, I will not allow you to control me. My emotions belong to me. My emotions come from my thoughts. I can control my thoughts. I can ensure that certain thoughts don't all the time get away with me. So I minimize that. I bring my thoughts to control. I take my thoughts towards positive and pleasant and nice things. And thereby, my emotions also become calm and peaceful and positive. And when my emotions are good, my actions are good, my words are good, I am at peace with myself. And I'm in harmony with most of the other people who are not critical of me. So my mental health is good. As simple as that. So before we wind up, I just wanted to tell you that please understand, and if you agree to anything that we say in these Saturday sessions, I'm not even saying you have to agree with everything. Maybe I've said certain things which you don't agree with, which you say, no, sorry, I don't think this is right. I would like to do it in a different way. I don't like to do it in this manner or whatever it is. So if you can, get away with that, you can do wonders with your life. So that's how we keep going about this whole thing. We keep getting some very interesting, inputs. Today, for example, my dear friend Surekha is traveling and she couldn't log in. She said she will do it later because she always comes out with some very good suggestions, very good comments. There are so many others like that, regulars who add to my thinking and my knowledge and my understanding, even by asking certain questions. So when I think about what answer to give, we don't have to, worry about anything, which is what Roshan said just now, that sometimes emotional distancing works automatically without making an effort. We forced ourselves to go to my son's house and all the trains were canceled. So now we have returned to our sweet home. We are happy and my son is most happy as we are not being with him. That's what they say, no? Sometimes even the universe conspires to help you when you have good intentions. So keep up that thing and work on that. It doesn't matter. I just wanted to tell you before we wind up the session that there was a suggestion on a very unusual topic. Most women in the productive stage of their life, they go through a phase just before their periods, which is called PMS, premenstrual syndrome. The biological factor and this and that, the hormonal and all that is fine. That you can talk to gynecologists, they'll tell you. But it has a lot to do with emotions. There are so many women whose emotions go into a turmoil. So this particular suggestion, incidentally and surprisingly, came from a man. Probably, he's having to suffer a lot because his wife goes through PMS. I didn't ask him that. But the fact is that these are some of the issues which are so unusual and at the same time sort of, stigmatized. Nobody wants to talk about it. We keep away from it. But it affects so many lives. Not just the woman who's going through the PMS syndrome, but her partner, her children, her best friend, so many people get affected by it. So what I'm doing is I've started doing more and more. I have had many, many cases of people with PMS. I've, counseled couples where PMS is affecting their relationship, etc. But I thought, let me go deeper into it and then I'll fix up a date and announce it to you so that, if you want, you can participate. But since this is a very unusual topic, I would love it if I can get some inputs from you people. It can be anonymous also, it doesn't matter. But whatever your experiences on these things have been, because people don't openly talk about it. So if I can get some inputs from you people, it will help me to compile the data and to make a better presentation as in when we fix up the date for giving out that thing. Now, as far as our regular Saturdays are concerned, we will be meeting again next Saturday. And next Saturday, the topic is little negative, but something which we do need to understand: personality disorders. How do you identify and deal with personality disorders? I'm not talking about major mental illnesses like schizophrenia and bipolar and Alzheimer's and all. No, I'm talking about personality disorders, which are such a hazy thing. There's no defining line between a person who behaves in an unusual and unacceptable manner and a person who is actually going through personality disorders. So keeping that in mind, I've already compiled enough data, so I'll be ready next Saturday, which happens to be 11th of November, between 2 to 3 as usual. Now the timing has been fixed and it's very comfortable for everybody. A lot of people are finding it more convenient because just after lunch on a Saturday afternoon, they can just relax and watch or hear this. And those who can't do it, they can catch up through the FB page anytime later after the program is over. So with that, I take your leave. And I hope to be with you all on 11th November. Bye-bye.